Thanks very much, John. I can now understand some of my own history from how John has actually told it back to me. You need somebody else to reflect on you to understand yourself. Great to be here. First of all, I think you had sent you in advance a handout. Some of you may have your copy with you or have it electronically, but knowing that many of you will not want to put it in your bag for travel, we do have some spare copies. John, before you go away, if you put your hand up if you need a hard copy, and keep that up until you've got one, I think we've probably got enough for to be distributed, because you will need to dip into this during my talk. Oh, great to be back here in Perth, that's right, it's where I can tell I'm jet lagged, that's where I flew from only yesterday, back in Adelaide. I was actually physically here 15 months ago, but actually I was here virtually, I suppose, only about 6 weeks ago. In October, they held a Students as Partners Network conference here, at about 6 in the morning in the UK, I was sitting in my study, and I did it via sort of video link. So I had seen some of this room, but I hadn't appreciated what a wonderful venue this is. It's a lovely place. So just to get a flavour, how many of you have been in a presentation I have made before? Okay, most of you are new to it. That's good. That means I can tell some stories, and it doesn't mean you've heard them all before. You'll see from the title, that quote, that this is an aspiration. That my aspiration is that there should be opportunities for all students in all higher education institutions to learn through the Students as Partnership, that to be engaged in partnership. And as John said, this is a rather broader framework that I want to put. So in a sense, I want to challenge you in terms of, melt your mind. My challenge to you is to actually think differently about the role of students in teaching and learning, and hopefully come up with something different that you'd like to actually put into context, into place in your context. My context is teaching and learning in higher education. I know others of you come from other sectors of education. And I think the ideas I talk about not only are applicable to those, but actually we have a lot to learn from you. Some of the most radical ideas about students as partnership actually come from the school sector, and higher education is in a catch-up mode. So I think we have things to learn from each other there. Again, let's just get a flavour. We've seen the geographical distribution. I'm a geographer, and I love to see that international context. But I want to see what the distribution is in terms of role. I'm going to give you three roles, and some of you will have more than one role. You have to choose one of these. So A, you're primarily a teacher, lecturer, tutor. B, you're primarily a learning support administrator. Or C, you're a student. Those are the three categories. You have to choose one of them. So put your hand up if you're primarily a teacher. Yeah, the majority, as I expected. Primarily a learning support administrator. Primarily a student. We have got a couple, good, three. There we are, great. I know it's the time of year and it's difficult, but I did challenge John to try and get some students here, because we're missing half the audience. We're talking about students as partners, and we haven't got students present. Something's wrong. So if we run this session again, my challenge is to get half the audience to be students around student partnership. I gave a workshop a few years ago in the Netherlands. I was invited there. I got something out of the blues. They heard I was coming to the Netherlands, and they were going to put a conference on because I was there. Wonderful, how great. And I didn't realize until about a month into the preparations that it was actually four students who had invited me. And they were organizing the conference, and it was held in the Student Union Building. 70% of the audience were students. The staff were, the teachers were in a minority. That changed the discourse. And so if you're serious about students as partners, you need to have both groups. You need to be in partnership, in other words. Now, melt your mind. When I saw this, I thought, is John just playing with us? Or is this an educational concept I haven't heard about before? So I thought I'd Google it. I didn't actually find an educational concept, but I did find a couple of things which I thought were interesting, which were relevant. There's some Dave McDowell has some wonderful artwork, and he talks about it, the mind melting. So I thought it's very appropriate artwork. And here we have Jimi Hendrix being brought together with Alice in Wonderland. I thought, now that's a challenge. That's going to melt your mind. And another one of his arts ones was this one. So Gollum meets Burger King. You know, you think differently when you put those two in juxtaposition. So that's the flavour, I think, of both my talk and I hope for this session, that we do try and melt our minds and think a little bit differently, think a little bit outside the box. John's introduced to me. I'm a geographer, as I said, by training. I was professor of geography at the University of Gloucestershire in 2010 when there was a reorganisation and didn't have much choice. And I left and set up as a higher education consultant. And it's been a wonderful life. Many of you in your careers will be faced with reorganisation and may have to move on. There is life after reorganisation. In fact, I wish now I'd left a little earlier. So I get the privilege of travelling the world, coming to meet really interesting people, and not having any performance indicators to meet. You know, I decide what they are, which is wonderful. Now, two or three of you who put your hands up, or a few of you who put your hands up, have been in my presentations before. You probably have seen or know what I'm going to say next, because I have to introduce you to some important members of our family. And at dinner, I know this is going to be important because we were swapping our iPhones at dinner, showing each other our pictures of our dogs. So this is what I'm going to do now. And this is Tess. And she's the girlfriend of Barney, who's Phil Levy's golden retriever. Tess was very upset when, 2.5 years ago, they left the UK. We lived only about 40 miles apart, so we got together sometimes. But coming to Adelaide, I don't think we're going to be following that one. So Tess is over 11 years old, and she's editing her Facebook page. So you dog lovers, see if you can join with her. But then, almost 3 years ago, we were joined by Sam. that's the right one, isn't it? So that's when we first picked her up. She's got a better, a more recent computer. So she's editing her pictures on my website. So if you like dogs, go on my website, and a whole series of pictures telling the story of our dogs. And then in August, we were joined by Meg. Meg said, oh, computers, that's all her. I'm going to learn to drive, she says, so I'm giving her a test run here. There. And both Sam and Meg are cousins, and they are great nieces of Tess. So they're all part of the broader family. There will be a theme of dogs and cats that goes through all my workshops. It's my unique selling point. I'm the only lecturer is known that. There was a lovely story. I gave a workshop at the University of Essex a couple of years ago. And I was walking around, and somebody said, Mick, have you ever been to Wollongong? I said, yeah, actually, I was there last August and a few years ago. He said, ah, I was in your workshop a few years ago. I couldn't remember you, but I remembered your dog. I thought, it's working. right, so in this hour and a half slot, this is the agenda for it. I want to unpack a little bit about what students as partners means, look at one or two conceptual frameworks that may help us to put that into place. We spent much of the time looking at some case studies. It's another of my signature pedagogies. When I give most presentations, there's usually a quite extensive handout with lots of mini case studies. And my experience is that's really what people value. That's where it comes alive. They see things working in another institution, another discipline context, and see where those ideas may or may not be transferable. And then, if we have time, a little bit of action planning at the end. But I wanted, as an icebreaker, to do what I often do in workshops, and do what I call 1 minute each way. And you've got to do it, it's a number of stages. First of all, you have to identify a partner. It doesn't have to be a student or a staff, whoever is sitting closest to you, but some of you may need to turn around. If you've got odd numbers, you may even have to stand up to go to somebody else who's there. Once you've identified your partner, you have to identify who's going to speak first, then the topic you're going to talk about is some experience you've had or an example you're familiar with, which you'd like to have, about engaged learning and teaching through student partnership. So it's telling each other a story, and you'll have 1 minute each there. Now, the challenge is for the person who's listening not to interrupt their colleague. And the challenge for the person talking is you've got to get a story out in 1 minute, and it's not very long. So don't spend time introducing yourself and where you're from. The minute will have disappeared. So can you identify your partner, first of all? And some of you may need to stand up to do that. I'd like to just get a feeling of a few of the stories you've heard. So I'd like just people to volunteer to tell you a story you've heard, not one you told, but one you heard from your partner, very briefly, give us a flavour for it. Now, we are recording this session, so whenever we have, this is going to be an interactive session, so whenever we you want to talk, if you put your hand up, and we've got a couple of roving mics coming round, so if you just wait till you've got your microphone before you make your comment. And you might like, to, in the principle of sharing, you could just say who you are and where you're from, so that we begin to place individuals as well. That would be very helpful. So who would like to share a story they've just heard from their partner? You can stand if you want to, but there's no need.
Oh, okay. I wasn't listening to the instructions very well. So my partner...
So who are you?
Aurora Chow from ANU. From Canberra. So my partner works in the biomedical sciences, and her students in an ideal world would get lots of time in the lab where they could try things, if it didn't work, repeat, keep going, and practice skills over and over, but they don't have access to the labs to do that iterative process. And so she asked them how they could solve that problem, and the solution to the problems with this was that they all got to wear GoPros and record themselves doing the experiment, and then even if it didn't go very well the first time, they could watch the video back and she could critique them. Yeah. Afterwards, so it extended that lab time more than what they actually had the access to, and they got a lot out of it, and she said she did too.
Lovely. Great story. Thank you very much. I've been to ANU several times, and I know lots of wonderful examples there, and I think there will be a few ANU examples in my handout. Another story. Right, next to you.
Yeah. Me. Hi, I'm Tara Shepperson from Eastern Kentucky University.
Hi, Tara.
And my partner is from the Singapore Institute of Technology. And he had a wonderful story. He's in hospitality, teaching hospitality, and he takes his students and they work in groups, and each group take a topic ranging from, you know, geography to marketing around cruises. And they have to develop the lecture and the activities for the entire class. So he kind of consults with them on content, but he enjoys, first of all, their activities that they devise for fellow students, and also, quite honestly, they can design presentations, perhaps better than some of us, and so takes advantage of that.
Good, great. Another great story, in the sense that, you know, the students are acting as teachers, and as we know, the best way to learn is to teach somebody else. I think we could do a lot more of encouraging our students to teach each other. There's one here at the front this side. Yes?
Up from University of South Australia, and my colleague here, Sean, from Macquarie University, actually brought a different perspective than teaching, but rather the idea of a resource for students in as a research librarian. A couple of students were having problems, international students, with referencing, you know, the typical problem of citation, Harvard citation type thing. And he introduced them to EndNote, which they went back to their cohort, and suddenly there was a groundswell, and they emerged en masse to ask Sean to then run workshops for them on EndNote and how that could be useful in their studies, and especially in their referencing and research of the literature.
Yeah. Okay. Lovely. So it's an example there of, in a sense, pass it on. And then exactly. It's developing a learning community. One more comment. Anyone want to share?
Hi, I'm Diane from UNSW Sydney, and I spoke with Beth Levies from the University of Adelaide, and she had a great idea where she actually had students design an assessment. So she gave them the learning outcomes, and they then had to work backwards. And Beth said it turned out to be quite a very challenging assessment. So you would think they might develop something that was rather easy, but this wasn't the case. It was quite difficult. And she's tested it out on a group of students, and they really enjoyed it. So, you know, get the students to design your next assessment.
Okay. So was that the assessment those particular students did, or was it the next cohort of students who did it?
It was the next set, yeah. Right. So the previous cohort designed it for the incoming cohort.
Then you understand why it was harder. I have got a few examples where the students have actually identified the assessment for themselves and negotiated that. And that, I think, is particularly powerful, but is actually particularly challenging, because our QA procedures usually mean that the assessment's got to be determined 3 months before you've got the students on the course. But if you can get that flexibility, agree the learning outcomes, as long as the assessments meet the learning outcomes, they're negotiable, that's a great way of moving forward. And because the students have to understand, particularly if they have to give marking criteria, they really learn an awful lot in actually devising that assessment in itself. Yeah. So thank you very much, and I hope during this talk and later we'll be able to share many more stories, and that's part of the principle of here, as John said at the beginning, of sharing as a learning community. Language of students as partners. As John indicated, it's an area I've really moved into, but in reflecting back, I realise I've done quite a lot of this for many years. Some almost since I started teaching, others perhaps more recently. But I haven't used the language of partnership, and that's quite common there. But the act of making it explicit and talking about students as partners does change things. It changes actually how we think about who the students are, what their roles are, and it challenges us to do things a bit differently. And that's just the act of making it explicit and changing the language. So to give a little bit on language, I'd like you to have a look at this quote. Can everyone read that from where they're sitting? I won't read it out then. This comes to the introduction to a very influential pamphlet on students of change agents, written by Liz Dunn and Zoe Zandastra. This comes from the preface that Liz wrote. And she makes what to me is, I think, quite a fundamental distinction. I often, in giving workshops, people in the exercise we've just done, I have examples, well, I asked my students and then I made some changes to them. We're pretty good at collecting the student voice in higher education. We have whole industries for collecting that, the happy faces forms and various forms of feedback we get. We have, in governance procedures, we're pretty good at getting students involved on various committees, at least in the Western world, making some changes to their representation system. For me, students as partners is going beyond the student voice. It's when the students actually come and are sitting at the table with us and actually making the decisions with us. They're acting in partnership rather than just giving us our views and then we decide whether or not we listen to those views. If they meet our particular prejudice, they say, well, that's a great view, the students think that. If not, then we say, oh, that's not possible, and we ignore it. A bit of a caricature, but it often happens. So for me, students as partners is very much more a students as co-producer, co-designer, co-researcher, co-creator of the teaching and learning. And it's often been, it's been relatively recently argued that students as partners is a good example of a threshold concept. How many of you are familiar with that idea of a threshold concept? There'll be a few of you, a good number here. It's a very powerful idea that's come into the literature in the last 10 years or so, really from the work of Ray Land and Eric Mayer in the UK. And their argument is that in every discipline, you can identify particular sort of meso-level concepts which students actually often have some trouble grasping. They're often known as troublesome knowledge. And it takes them a little while to get hold of it, to understand it, and they go through what's called a liminal space where they're trying to grasp with it, go back and that. But once they've really grasped it and they've gone through the portal, there's no going back. They see the world differently. So in economics, for example, if you understand the principle of opportunity cost, you see the world differently and you see economic costs. If you're in design, thinking in 3D terms, you see the world differently and be able to design things and be able to imagine that and capture that in your own mind before you design your own ones. If you're in geology, you see things in 4D because you've got to see it in the time dimension as well. As a geographer, the idea of spatial scale is important, from local to regional to national, different scales. Every discipline has their own threshold concepts. And I think students as partners is a threshold concept in the learning and teaching area. It takes a while to grasp it, certainly to actually have experience and try it out, that takes a while. But once you've done it, you see the world differently. There's no going back. You wouldn't think of not involving students in some form there. Not in everything you do, that may not be feasible. But you would actually see the desire of doing that and then build those into various activities. And I thought I'd give you an example, a more political one, that I think we heard Phil saying the post-truth world associated with a particular individual, but this individual you might see differently, having seen this cartoon. Yeah. So just think of Donald Duck when the next time he appears on television, and perhaps he'll give you a bit more humour, and you won't necessarily, as happens in our household, whenever he comes on television, Chris mutes the screen and she swears at it. So, defining partnership. We were involved through Phil's procedure when she was at the HEA. She commissioned me to work with a couple of colleagues at the HEA on writing a sort of guide to the literature on students as partners. This is the nearest we got to a definition, and it's perhaps a little bit of a negative one in some ways. It's not so much what you do, it's how you do it. And so the process is rather more important than the product. It's a way of thinking. It's an approach. And that, I think, is the important thing. The process is more important than the outcome itself. One of the conceptual modules which I find particularly helpful in getting my head around things is associated with the work of Kathy Beauville. She was at Glasgow, now at Edinburgh. You may not be able to see it, but I think it's on the handout, isn't it? Yeah, so on page 2 on the handout. You can see it. And this is a ladder of participation. She pinched the ideas from Einstein's work about participation in local communities and applied it into higher education and curriculum development. And at the bottom of the ladder, the curriculum is, the students come in, it's a take it or leave it. This is what the curriculum is, this is what you're going to get. No choice, no selection. As you begin to move up that ladder, more and more choice begins to come in. Till you're about halfway, three quarters of the way up there, when you're actually having a lot of negotiation or can actually even have control of aspects of that curriculum. To the very top of the ladder, when actually the students have a bigger voice than we do, in actually what it is. Some independent learning courses might fit in that way. And I have one or two examples, we might look at one later, where that is the case. They're rare, but it's worth seeing. The main point, I think, about the ladder is to say there's no right or wrong place to be. In different elements, you might well be at the bottom of the ladder, and another one you might be, you know, a third or two-thirds of the way up. The variety is actually important, and it's not an argument to say everybody needs to be in the top half of that ladder. But what I would argue is that perhaps, as a community, we ought to consider taking one or two steps up that ladder. And that's my challenge to you, to think about how you might take a step up. And the next time you run a particular event, you think, well, with this one, this is the course I'm going to experiment on this semester, and I'm going to give the students a little bit more choice, a little bit more negotiation there, and think about how you might do that. So the challenge is to take a few steps on that ladder, but certainly not be necessarily doing it with everything that you do. Now, the model that we developed in that 2014 publication, which is freely available from the Higher Education Academy, you can download it if you're interested. And it's really no more than a classification. People seem to have found it useful. Because our argument was that there are perhaps two fairly distinct approaches in higher education to having students as partners. On the left-hand side, it's students as partners in learning, teaching, and research. On the right-hand side, it's students as partners in quality enhancement. And quite a few people say they are working as students as partners, but only mean one side or other of that divide. So I think one of the contributions of that model was to actually see the variety and bring it together in a holistic model. And it's important also about how that plays out in the real world. On the left-hand side, there are plenty of examples of that where the whole class or the whole program, or very rarely the whole institution, all students will be engaged in it. It's possible to scale it up, and there are many examples of that. On the right-hand side, on the other hand, it tends often to be just a handful of students, two or three students you've involved in that particular activity. There are lots of debates about how we can scale that up, but sometimes it's not even possible or even desirable. It's quite appropriate to have just a small handful of students involved in that. So I think that's quite an important difference. And you'll see the outer circle is student engagement. Students as partners is a subset of student engagement. but not all student engagement involves students as partners. Now that's, I think, quite a useful distinction. And then we identified four different areas within the big circle, four circles, overlapping circles. Top left, students involved in learning, teaching, assessment. If we're teachers, we all do aspects of that. Peer learning, peer assessment, most of us will do aspects of that. When a student gives a workshop, gives a seminar to the others, they can be acting as teachers. And we have one or two examples of that in the 1 minute one. We might not use the term partnership, but we do that, it's very common. Subject-based research and inquiry, very much what we're talking about these 2 days, is students doing research and inquiry themselves. And the techniques which are involved as with the RSD framework. On the bottom right, it's when students get involved in the scholarship of teaching and learning, when they're actually investigating the teaching that they received, what they receive. Normally, that's what we as faculty do, and investigate. But my question to you is, why not get some of your students to do it? Some of your students will really be fascinated by the teaching they're receiving, not just the chemistry or the law or the engineering, what the subject is. Open up your projects so that students who are interested could do a project on the learning and teaching of your discipline, as well as the other sub-disciplines. And then the top right, and this is probably the smallest circle in many ways, where students get involved in curriculum design and acting as pedagogic consultants. Again, this is an area most staff, most faculty see, that's our job. You know, why do the students get involved in that? But when I've seen it operate, it's actually made a significant difference to the curriculum design and to the learning. I'll just give you one brief example. Alison Cook-Sather at Bryn Mawr College in the States has done this for many years, and she gets faculty to invite a student in to come and sit in their class and observe what's happening. Many of us around the world have faculty come in and sit in our classes and give us feedback, but it's rare to have a student come in. It's not a student you teach, it would be a power relationship there. It's a student actually sometimes from a different discipline who would come in. And you negotiate what you want them to look at. So you might say, look, I'm trying out something new there. I'm moving up, perhaps, in the students and partnership ladder. I'm trying something new. Invite another student to come in and see what's happening. And they sit in your class. It could be just one session, but in Alison's case, it's a whole semester, and she pays them to do that. And they make observations. They listen into groups. And most critically, they go and have coffee with the students afterwards. And they can have conversations in the cafe, which you would never get with those students. And then they come and feed back to you what they are. They're acting as a consultant, a pedagogic consultant to you. It's a very powerful way of sharing ideas, and it's a very different role for the students. Now, many of you know I've worked with Alan Jenkins for well over a decade now, I'm really talking now about that top left, I've jumped a slide to where I thought it was. Yeah, the four circles you saw, I want you to have a look at some case studies now. Some of you may have read these in advance, so you've got the handout. Others will have a few moments to quickly skim read one example. And I use that framework, the first four, the four circles there, and the page number is on there where you'll find two or three examples there from different parts of the world. But I've added a fifth one called integrated approaches because many of these examples fit under more than one circle. And the integrated approaches actually probably relate to two, three, or four circles at the same time. So what I'd like you to do now is compare with the circles sitting next to you, choose a different example to quickly skim read. And you'll only have time to look at one example, so make sure you're taking a different heading and then just choose one example. So always start with the very first one. Sometimes the last one in the heading may be more interesting to you. But quickly choose one, skim read it, and then share with your neighbours something interesting that you've been reading. Now, time is short in this. It's a quick one. If you've already read it and you already know the examples you want, you can always start a discussion immediately. But the idea is not to summarise everything you say, but something interesting I've just read about this was. And isn't this a great idea? I'm going to consider doing this in my context. Is that the sort of conversation I want you to have? So in about the next sort of 5 minutes, and then I'm going to ask a few people to share what they found the interesting ideas were. Now, if you start an example and you find it boring, or I've done that for many years, life's too short. Find a different example. But do skim read at least one example in the next few minutes and have a conversation with the person sitting next to you. When you hear the Tibetan prayer chimes, it's come back to melt again. I think it's a lovely sound. I was given these in Amsterdam about 5 years ago, and they thought I had difficulty getting the audience back together. And I said, it's a lovely sound, not quite loud enough unless I get a mic right next to it so you can hear it. But when I read about them, I thought, how appropriate, because the idea of them is to encourage positive and reflective thinking. What more could you want in a learning and teaching session? So I'm going to invite some of you to tell us about the things that you found interesting. What I don't want to hear is, that's a load of rubbish, it wouldn't work in my context. So let's go for the positive, go for appreciative inquiry, why you think these are fascinating, isn't that? And with some modification, I might be able to use it. Or tell us about some experience you already have. Don't be limited to the examples I've given. If you want to share something you do in your context and tell people about that, please take the opportunity to do that. So in that spirit, what were the positive ideas that you felt? We already have somebody at the front who's over here. Yes, gentleman at the front.
So my partner and I discussed the number 4, curriculum design and pedagogical consultancy, on page 10. One question we're wondering is that what are the incentives that you can get all the previous students engaged, involved into developing the pedagogical, because there's a huge time commitment into this. You have weekly meetings, or you meet multiple times per week. In addition to the $700 incentive, the money, can we get something additional to engage the students into the pedagogical design?
Okay.
This is something. Next thing is about it's all about the. Is this could be used in undergraduate level? How about the master level or PhD level? So at those different levels, we may need to think differently in how we can get
and
them engaged.
Just say who you are and where you're from.
Oh, this is George from Singapore Institute of Technology. Yeah, just now my partner already shared my experience of engaging students into teaching a cruise management course.
Lovely. Thank you very much.
So thanks.
A couple of questions. I'll broaden out my answer. If you're serious about trying to scale up and make it students as partners an opportunity for all, at some point you need to address that bigger issue of what's in it for the students. Most initiatives start off with volunteers, and many students are only too pleased and delighted to be asked to be involved in it. They really feel they're special to do that. And that's fine in the early days, and some will continue to volunteer. But some won't be able to volunteer because, you know, the time they have to put in, they're missing an earning opportunity or a learning opportunity there. So generally in this area, you do one of two things. You either pay the students for their time or you give them credit. You know, it's built into their course ones. And some people make a choice. They actually negotiate. What do you want to get out of this? Well, you could do this as an independent studies module. We could pay you on research assistant rates. Or you could simply volunteer, and it'll go on your CV, and I'll write a reference for you. And that can be part of the negotiation. In terms of level of it, I focus on the undergraduate because I think it's perhaps more challenging in the undergraduate area. It's much easier, probably. And you go up to the doctoral level, the idea of a doctoral student is they might start off as you're the expert there. By the time they get, they should know more about the topic than you do, and they should be teaching you about it. So it's very easy there. And as I said, those of you in the school sector, they're really good examples at primary schools and secondary schools of students as partners operating at. Well before they come into higher education. So another comment, somebody found a case study they looked at interesting. Please, one here.
My name's Ray Tolhurst from the Australasian Institute of Mining and Metallurgy, Illawarra branch, so not from a university as such, but we work very closely in conjunction with the University of Wollongong. And the case study that we looked at was the one on 3.2 on scholarship of teaching and learning. And the example there relates somewhat closely to what we do with students in the delivery of mineral processing, that traditionally, right across the world, how you process minerals after they've been mined is taught in two ways. It's either done in a units operations approach, where you go through four steps of crushing and grinding, sizing, separation, dewatering, or you teach it by saying, here's how you process copper, here's how you process lead and zinc, here's how you process gold, here's how you process iron ore, etc. So what we do is, in the delivery, we do one method and the students do the other. And so the students are each given a project of a particular ore, and they use what they get from the second delivery method to enhance how they're going to process their ore. And we involve people from professionals from the industry through the online discussion site that the students use to comment on how they're going about it. What's in it for the students? They build up their networks with professionals in industry, and they get contacts for getting VAC work or potentially graduate positions.
Okay, thank you very much. As a lovely example, in the sense of work-integrated learning, how you can get this linked in with the in the profession. I think in terms of the example you gave, perhaps fits even better under the second one, subject-based research and inquiry, because it's very discipline-based and related, and they're inquiring and learning through inquiry. Whereas the third one is much more about the students learning about how to learn and investigating the learning that's taking place and their partnerships in there. Those of you who looked at that, some of you may have looked at the first one, 3.1 Exeter, or the 3.3 Sheffield. Both are very similar in the sense that students are acting as change agents. They are investigating some of the learning they teaching they receive, and then making proposals to the institution on the basis of what they found through that research into the teaching and learning. Exeter was the lead on this. They've been doing it for over 10 years now, and now it's just commonplace what they do. Every department in Exeter has had several students over the years undertake this activity. And in the early days, the deal was that if they were in a sense given permission to do this, and it was voluntary in most of the time they've been doing it, and they might be provided with a little bit of technical support. So, for example, if you're an engineer and you want to collect some data, and the best way to do that is a focus group, a master's student might advise you on how to actually undertake a focus group, because you've never heard of that perhaps before. But the deal is that you then gave a presentation on your findings to a cross-university conference. And the critical thing was that every senior manager had a three-line whip to come to that conference. It wasn't just a matter of students talking to students and the one facilitator who happened to be there, which is the most common way that happens. The deans, the heads of departments, would be asked to turn up to that conference. So the students suddenly saw that their views and their research was being taken seriously. And I think that was very important. And one of the things that occurred in the early days, in the business school, they'd started, this was about 7 years ago, they started using clickers, those voting systems where you actually say, and those days they were clickers. You actually handed out a clicker and you did the voting system. Nowadays we use mobile phones to do the same thing. But it was new, and the students said, look, we've never come across this before. We want to investigate the student experience of the use of clickers in the classroom. And when they made their presentation, they came up with so many benefits that the other students were telling them they got to their benefits for their learning from the use of this technology, that the dean of the business school who was there stood up at the end of the meeting and thanked them and said, okay, you've convinced me. Tomorrow I'm going to order 4,000 clickers so that every single undergraduate and taught postgraduate student has their own clicker they can take to every class. I don't believe if you were a member of faculty in the business school, you'd have quite got that response if you'd knocked on the dean's door the day before. Students can sometimes make changes we can't, or faculty can't do. That's a rather dramatic example of a change which occurs. In many cases, it would not be appropriate to make a change. But in a sense, the staff are being put on the spot to say why we don't think that's appropriate, or why we need to do something slightly differently from that. And that's having a discussion and bringing it out. And if you think about how most curriculum decisions are made in higher education, they're actually rarely based on research. So actually have somebody doing some research, it happens to be the students, and having some data there, right, is, I think, itself a step forward, rather than do it on the basis of our own prejudices of what should be in the next course. One more example somebody found interesting. Did anybody look at the fifth heading, the integrated approaches? Anyone found an interesting example there? Please, on the side.
OK. Thank you. Hi, my name is Kristen. I'm from Southern Cross University in Lismore. The integrated approaches really interest a couple of us in this group, not just because there was a very beautiful picture and not just lots of words. and I think the notion of actually students as partners and co-designers in a connected curriculum framework was particularly rich, and having that through that, you know, I think it's one of the issues is that that whole course view. It's tricky for us without students as partners, but looking at it with students as partners, I think, is a really rich way forward and something I'd be very inspired to take back to colleagues. Southern Cross University is really keen on engaged approaches, not just... so that's regional engagement with our community. So how do we also bring students in and ensure they can co-design the curriculum as well as the industry and community partners? So these frameworks are really rich from my perspective.
Again, thank you. The last two or three people spoken, Macquarie University and SCU. I've been to both places several times, so I know the context in which you're working. I'm glad you chose that study, because I think that's particularly relevant to our discussions today. It's at UCL, University College London, and indeed Adelaide and McMaster University have a link with there. We were all in at UCL in July, or say all, there were about 15-20 people from Adelaide flew out to UCL for a conference in July. And this is their approach to linking teaching and research and taking quite a strategic approach called the connected curriculum. It's becoming very influential and very well. And Dilly Fung, who's been leading that initiative, has now published a book and some edited collections which have also come out, again on open access through UCL Press. And what really intrigues me is this is a strategic approach. I had the honour of being a visiting professor there for the last 3 years, helping them to implement this approach across the institution. So it's the petal diagram on page 11. If you haven't had a look at that yet, I would encourage you. Give you some ideas about how to be strategic about embedding research right across an institution. And in a variety of ways. And UCL is a research-intensive university. Michael Arthur, who became the president of that institution in 2014, he developed a strategy, the 2034 strategy for UCL, a 20-year strategy. And he said, even though this is a research-intensive university, to implement this is going to be a cultural change. And he took a commitment that every undergraduate student would have an authentic research experience if they came to UCL. And he realised that takes a long time to implement that. They're doing lots of interesting things already in UCL. Quite a lot of my examples come from UCL on there. But they recognise a culture change takes time. This isn't just a 1 year, 2 year, or even a 5 year strategy. They'll have those and they'll want to move along the agenda, and they're moving along quite fast. So if you want a strategic one, do have a look at that. And that provides a nice segue into what I want to focus in for the last sort of 40 minutes of my presentation. And that's to focus actually rather more on the bottom half of the diagram, the bottom two circles in that diagram, about engaging students in research and inquiry and engaging them in scholarship of learning and teaching. Both ways of engaging research and inquiry, whether it's a subject matter or the learning and teaching. And that really focuses in rather more on the subject of this conference. First of all, a quote from Alison Cook Sather, a comment I frequently get is from, look, I've had 4 years experience, then I did a PhD, and 10 years teaching experience. I'm the expert. What on earth can the students bring? This is the answer to that question. The principle of students as partners is to recognize that everybody brings some expertise to the table, but it's a different expertise. The students are experts at being students and having that. And actually, they have a different view of teaching and learning than we do and experience. They actually are very privileged. They get a helicopter view of the course because they're taking, 10, 15 different units across our courses. We only need to see the two or three that we personally teach. So they have a different view that we have of the programs that we teach. And they're experiencing it, you know, what it's like to be a learner in that. We forget, the older we get, the more difficult it is to put our position to be a student, to think what they are experiencing. And the troubles and difficulties they are having in learning, which we just take as obvious now. So students as partners, recognising that everyone has some expertise. Now, in developing a research active curriculum, and I began to say when I lost my position on the slides, that Alan Jenkins and I have argued for many years that we want all students to be involved in this. And we were specifically then talking about research and inquiry. I paraphrased that quote earlier to be broader, to be involved in a whole students as partners agenda, because I think it still applies there. That may be more challenging in some areas than others. And I think the only way you can provide that opportunity for all students to have research inquiry, it has to be embedded in the curriculum. In many, particularly in North America, the undergraduate research movement, much of that undergraduate research movement is extracurricular. It's working for 6 weeks in the summer in a lab. Wonderful experience, great for those who get it. But if you really want everybody to have an opportunity, I think you have to integrate it into the course for credit to provide that opportunity. I'll take a quote from Angela Brew. Her name has been mentioned a number of times. English, but we've been working in Australia for well over 20 years now. I think it's a very powerful quote that Daniel has put there, very much the same argument of saying this is not just for students who are going to want to become researchers in some form. It's for all our students. The skills that they gain being involved in research and inquiry are just the same skills that you want to be a professional in the 21st century. That's the mainstreaming argument. You'll actually gain it. It's one of the relatively few agendas in higher education which actually plays out in the most extreme research-intensive unit, ANU. I know no more university, no more intense. If you're not familiar with ANU, something like 85% of faculty at ANU are research-only, teaching in a minority interest at ANU. Actually, I was invited to give the very first learning and teaching workshop there a few years ago, and I think that's been brought in to sort of boost that 15% who thought they were a bit of a minority and say, you're really doing great things, and they are. Or you're very teaching intensive, and your staff hardly do any research themselves. You play a different card if you're cunning about the policy. So in ANU, you would actually play the research training card. You train your undergraduates, and then you can get a better group of students to go on to do MPhil and do PhD students. You encourage them, and they can hit the ground running. In a teaching intensive university, you might much more play the employability card. The skills that you gain by being involved in that will make you more employable. Or you might play the widening participation card. We have an issue of high dropout rates for this group. Give them an intensive undergraduate research experience in the first year, and you may well find that the dropout rates actually are reduced. And a number of universities around the world, I know, have used that particular strategy. So it's an argument which plays right across the higher education sector. Now, John's classic model, which came out in 2007, and really is the basis of this conference. Some of you may be familiar with one I produced a couple of years earlier, and they're very complementary. Yeah. So how many people have seen this diagram before? Okay, a minority, interesting, yeah. This is going to be on my gravestone. I'm known around the world for this diagram, and that's all I'm known for, one diagram, you know, after over 40 years in higher education. So my impact factor is rather limited, and I pinch most of the ideas from somebody else. They should get credit for it rather than I get credit. But I always give credit to Ron Griffiths, University of West of England, who wrote about three of the ideas in this diagram, but he wrote about them. I put them into a diagram, and that taught me an important lesson. If you put things in diagrams, people remember them more than it's simply in text. And so I get this is the most cited thing, the most reproduced thing I've ever done, is this diagram. As most of you didn't know, let me quickly run through it. If you look at the axes, top to bottom, students primarily an audience to students as active participants, and left to right, emphasis on the content or emphasis on processes and problems. Then Ron suggested we use particular terms to describe where students fitted or where that particular pedagogy fitted in the diagram. So he suggested we use the term research-led when we're talking about the content. I put it in the bottom half of the diagram, it's clearly on the left-hand side. I put it in the bottom half because the most common way students get content is in a lecture. And the lectures, though they can be quite active, tend to be a fairly passive way of learning. He suggested we use the term research-oriented when we're teaching the techniques. And much of the RSD framework overlaps with that particular area. The research skills and techniques, the way of thinking like a lawyer, thinking like a nurse, taking on that identity as well. Much more debatable where it fits top or bottom, because there are numerous pedagogies that we use to teach methods and techniques. But it's quite common to do a second or third level course, even entitled Research Methods and Techniques in X, whatever the subject happens to be, engineering or history or law. And you may have a lecture with 300 students there. Then you break them into either practical groups or seminar groups, depending on what the subject is, to explore those techniques in more depth. Then research-based, top right, that's when the students are learning by doing. Research-based learning, problem-based learning, context-based learning, case-based learning, X-based learning, all fit there. It's a learning by doing model. You learn the methods and techniques by doing the research and inquiry. And then there was a gap in my diagram where Ron didn't have a term for the top left, and I suggest the word research tutored, where we're learning through discussion. A one-to-one supervision is a wonderful way to learn. If you have a PhD student, you do that. We occasionally get that with upper-level students on their final year project or even capstone project, but it's fairly rare. But it could equally be a large group. We could have a class of 500. I've outlined an idea. I've asked you, as I have done today, turn to your neighbor and talk about that, and then invite two or three of you to feedback, and I feedback on your feedback. We are learning together through some discussion and debate of that. And a lot of flipped classroom models operate on that model, the discussion when you have people back together rather than spending all the time on transferring my notes into your notes without going to the head of either of us. So there are just four different ways in which students come across research. If we're teachers, we do all of them. So the interesting question is not do we link teaching research, because we all do it. The interesting question is what's the balance? And my general argument is too much of higher education is still in the bottom half of that diagram. It's still in that transmission mode rather than more active learning, student-centered learning in the top half. But I want to emphasize I value all four methods. I just think we've, in most courses, we've got the balance wrong, and so most of the examples I'll give will be in the top half, particularly the top right example. But I don't want to throw out lectures or throw out research skills tutorials and that. I just think perhaps we use at least the lecture too often for the wrong thing. We tend to use the lecture as a transmission mode of getting the content over. We think we've got it over because we've talked about it. We can tick a box. We've talked for 10 minutes on that particular subject. The real challenge is, what have the students learned from that? And you can only guarantee by the time they've left the lecture room, they've missed half of it. A week later, they're down to about 20%. A term later, unless they have a revision for an exam, much of it is already gone. So the learning isn't actually taking place. Not a very effective way of learning that we might think we've actually covered the topic. If you want learning, then more in-depth learning, getting students doing active learning, there's lots of evidence then of more retained learning. The challenge, of course, is that we can do, though active learning is a very effective way of learning, it takes time. And there's a trade-off between the amount of things you can do and the depth you can do it. And that's where a balance has to be struck. And only you can decide what the balance is appropriately. And that's how the model's been used. Have a discussion with colleagues you co-teach with on the course of the program and say, roughly what time do our students spend in those different boxes? And is that appropriate for achieving our learning outcomes we want to achieve? And if not, that might change. And you'll have different views from the different people having that conversation. But it's having the conversation which is powerful. And you may think we need to change the balance in revising that course from that discussion. So let's have a look at some specific examples. Now moving to pages 14 and 19, I've chosen some examples from subject-based research and inquiry and scholarship of teaching and learning. Depending where your interests are, choose one or the other, but make sure the example you choose, and there are several examples on those pages, choose at least one example, but it's different from the person sitting next to you. So we've covered a wider range. So just a few minutes dipping into the handout, and then we'll come back again for some discussion. It'll probably be a shorter time now. The Tibetan prayer chimes have rung out. And apologies, just as you start that interesting conversation, I'm going to interrupt you. My job is to make sure we finish for 12 o'clock, so we move on to the next part of the agenda. So let's same procedure as before, invitation to you to tell us something interesting that you liked on one of the examples that you've read, or something you do in your course that you'd like to share with us. There's one down here.
Example 1.9 on page 17, a biology startup business, and finally a project, University of Durham. Back in 1993, I was involved in helping set up a similar project in the biotechnology honours program at Flinders University.
So which university?
Flinders University.
Yeah, thank you.
And basically, the biotech course had an honours degree project which was identified in third year, and the students had to produce a business case of how they'd commercialise their biotech research as a patent or a registered trademark or something of that kind. And I was brought in to run a workshop on how to develop a business case, which students did in the summer vacation before they actually then went to do their actual final honours research. But this was all mapped out from first year. So actually I was saying to my colleague, one of the difficulties about engaging first years in this kind of inquiry is something people often find a little bit daunting. But in this case, a lot of the biotech students were so enthusiastic about doing a biotechnological course that they looked forward from first year to the third year, their honours proposal for the fourth year business case workshop so that they could actually make something in terms of their research as a real product and a real potential patent.
That's wonderful. I invite you, but others who've told us interesting case studies, to send me about 300 words in the sort of format that you've got on here, so that next time I run this workshop, I can share other ideas. And that's great. And I love it that it got involved from first year also. The variant they used at Durham was to involve students working alongside students from the business school. And they, in combination, had to come up with a business plan to put that into commercial production. And it's actually one in the UK, 85% roughly of students have to take a final year dissertation, a final year project. In the sciences, one of the problems they have is they don't have enough lab space for everybody to do a lab-based project. Some of them, I think, fudge it, and they say, well, that will be for the best students, those who want to go on to do research and have a lab one. The rest do a sort of literature review one, which I think is not necessarily an appropriate fudge. In Durham, they came up with the business case one as one variant, and another variant they did was to say, if you're interested in going on into teaching biology, why don't you produce some teaching resources for senior high school students on something in the curriculum which hasn't yet got through to the high school curriculum? And then when you apply to do your postgraduate certificate in teaching, you can say, I've already produced some teaching resources. I've already done something. So it becomes appropriate for them. And what you're doing effectively by having that variety is you're hitting the motivation of a greater proportion of students. In higher education, what we tend to do is give every student on the same cohort exactly the same assessment. It's argued that's equity. Rubbish. You can come up with a variety of ways of producing the same learning outcomes. And I guarantee if you just produce two different ones for testing the same learning outcomes, A, you're going to find that your student satisfaction scores go up. Sometimes we get measured on that. But B, your average marks should go up because people will be more motivated and prepared to put more effort in. So meeting the motivational card gives students some choice as part of it. Another example somebody found interesting. Please.
Lachlan Kelly from the International College of Hotel Management in Adelaide. I had a look at 1.12, giving students alternative assessment options for undertaking a product design project. Yeah. I think this is a really good idea. We are trying to move away from using traditional assessment with our students rather than sort of sticking to maybe two assignments and an exam at the end of the semester. I think this idea is great because it actually sort of takes away the box that students sometimes feel like they're stuck in, and it gives them the opportunity to maybe use some of the skills that they may not have for a certain type of assessment. So they've actually got the choice to choose maybe one or two different assessment options. I think it's a great idea.
Thank you. Again, that nicely illustrates the argument I was just making about giving a choice. In this case, they often negotiate the proportion of marks which are given to some different activities, and therefore where they'll put their effort in and where they see their own strengths and interests lying. Another example somebody found interesting. Please.
Hi, everyone. I'm Chakapedi from the University of the South Pacific. That's in Fiji. So in our course, it's a contemporary, it's a generic course for our 200-level undergraduate students. It's called Pacific Worlds. And in one of our major assessments, the students, because our university represents 12 member countries from the region, so you have at least students from 12 countries, plus others, international students included, so you have a great diversity of students. And the challenge for us, being a generic course, is to create assessments that would kind of like fit everyone. And we can all imagine how difficult that is. So for our major assessment, the students are required to either form groups or as individuals or in partners. They select a contemporary issue from their country, from their local community. And this is based on, number one, subject-based research and inquiry on page 14. So they select a contemporary issue from their local environment or their local society. They examine the causes of that particular issue, and they are required to suggest traditional and creative-based solutions. So in this particular assessment, students, they could compose a song, they could write a poem, they could do drama, they can do dances, they can carve. It not only draws on their academic ability, but because of our Pacific culture, we acknowledge the arts, and so it goes deeper than that, and it draws on, you know, it's very holistic because it draws on the Pacific culture as well. So because of students, I remember of the in the welcome, we're preparing our students for employability in the market. And these students, they will shape their nation's policy in the future. So when they talk about domestic violence, when they talk about corruption and many other issues that our Pacific Islands, challenges that our Pacific Islands are facing, through this assessment, the students actually come up with statistics and solutions based on their traditional values and using culture and the arts to find solutions which would be very relevant and practical when they go back home, something that they can actually implement, solutions that are not imposed on us, but it's coming from them, from us as Pacific Islanders. So it's overall, it's empowering, it's challenging, it really makes students confront issues that their countries are going through, and overall, we find it to be very effective. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. It's a lovely example of the cultural aspect coming into what we're doing. But I think we have a lot to learn in the sciences and social sciences from the arts, and that diversifying the assessment. So why does it always have to be a written thing? Why not produce a video? Why not do a performance? Let's be creative in the ways we think of assessing the learning outcomes that they do. They'll be challenging, but they'll really think outside the box. And there are examples around there of people who've done that. Now, we're in the last sort of 15 minutes, and I need to move it on and have to miss one or two things that I would have liked to have had time to talk about if we had the time. But this is the critical one. In the diagram at the center, and I hadn't really talked about that, the center of the diagram was developing learning partnerships. And you may have seen in the diagram in the outer circle, or the second circle in, there were a whole series of words which talk about the principles of working in partnership. This particular table, probably easy to follow on page one of the handout. And the Higher Education Academy, we developed a series of principles which to underlie partnership. And you see, they think the partnership should be authentic, they're honest, they're inclusive, there's reciprocity, both sides have something to get from it, there's empowerment, usually talking about empowering students, but in some cases it can be empowering faculty, there's trust, there's courage, because we're actually often taking both parties outside their comfort zone, so courage is involved in the case of both staff and students. Plurality, recognition of the different parties, and co-responsibility. It's not just the person who came up with the project who's responsible for delivering it, but all the people involved in the partnership have some responsibility. So what I'd like you to do very briefly now is think of an example you're familiar with, or perhaps one of the case studies you've just read, and to what extent do you think the principles we've just outlined are exhibited? And are some of those principles, do you think, more important than others? Or perhaps you had an experience and you might say, well, if only we'd teased out those principles first, we might have done a better project. It would have overcome some of the problems we had. So a brief discussion about the principles and their application. I'll put the principles back there, but they're on page one. Bring us together now. As a group, rather than individually, we're running out of time. So just an invitation for a couple of people to comment on these principles. Do you think some principles are more important than others? Have you had experience of using these type of ideas? So any comments on the principles and their application? Anyone think one principle perhaps more important than others? Yeah, oh, a couple coming in.
Hello, I'm Jenny Shanahan at Bridgewater State University, which is near Boston, Massachusetts in the U.S. Not that I thought one was more important, but when I got to responsibility, I took a little gasp because I realized that that's perhaps the most challenging for me, to not, as the staff member, attempt to make sure it all wraps up all right and that we have an outcome, but that I really need to let go of some of that, share the responsibility rather than be the fixer if things don't go exactly as I hoped.
Yeah, yeah. Thanks, Joe. I think that's really important. I find that challenging. I'm editing a journal at the moment, and some of my colleagues say, the fact that nobody's spoken doesn't mean they agree with you, Mick. you have to take that step backwards and give time for that discussion. I tend to be a bit of a control freak, and it is difficulty doing that. And that's challenging, and, you know, depending on our own style of working. But it's also a trust relationship, I think. It's trusting each other, and it does take time to do that. So I've seen many students as partners initiatives where it's only about 4 or 5 weeks into it, the students turn to it and say, you really do want us to be partners, Mick. They don't believe it. They think it's just an exercise that they're going through. So yeah, there are lots to do. But being honest about what is possible. Because yes, often we have a grant and we have a deadline to meet. We have some responsibility for delivering that. We may be able to help get the students to help us deliver that, but we can't give up that responsibility. And it's to be honest of what is possible, what constraints are we operating, what have we got to agree, what element of partnership can we agree for this period, often because it's what is possible in that timescale dimension. If we had longer, we could have given you more responsibility. That may not be possible. Being honest about it, I think, is the critical one. Any more comments on principles?
Hi, Sylvia Tiella, University of Wisconsin-Stout. In my work with both K-12 and university professors and myself, I would say the primary item is courage, to have the courage to take the first step, have the courage to fail, have the courage to get back up and try again and let your students know that you are partners and they have to have the courage to be a partner. So for me, that courage, as I've even worked with my peers, is to have that self-confidence to say, let's give her a try.
Lovely. Start small, think big. That's, I think, a good motto here. Okay, I need to wrap this up. That's the public cover of the publication, quite a few of these ideas we developed on. I said freely available to download. I will make these slides available to John so they can be passed on to you after the conference. I just mentioned I've been involved in a journal, some of you have heard, the International Journal of Students as Partners. We set that up only in the last sort of 18 months. And we take, like most journals, research articles, but we also have case studies and opinion pieces and reflective essays. But we want them to be, where possible, co-authored by staff and students. We'll accept articles only written by students or only written by staff, but it's an encouragement there. But we walk the talk. So we have an editorial board of 10 people here, which is international, it's in four countries, Australia, Canada, UK, and US, and each one, a member of staff, is working alongside a student. So the students are co-editing the journal and as equal members of that consortium. And all our articles will be read by at least one student in order to get through. So we accept that most students, and indeed some staff, will not have the experience of reviewing for a teaching and learning journal, let alone a Students as Partners one. So we've provided resources to train new reviewers. So there's an invitation for you, if you'd be interested, to go on our website and be a reviewer, get some of your students to do so also. It's a great way to get into the subject, to review an article or two first before you might contribute. We launched that journal last May at McMaster University. It's McMaster University Press of the publishers. It's open access journal. Anybody can read it. And that's Anita on the left, who's our US student. Some of you may know Lucy Mercer Mapstone from the University of Queensland, who works with Kelly Matthews at the University of Queensland as our two Australian co-editors. And it came out, really, the idea of the developing a journal from a summer institute that we started running a couple of years ago. And we're going to be running a third institute next June. So if any of you are interested in the Students as Partners and want to come over to McMaster in Ontario, the 11th to the 14th of June, we'd really love to see you there. You can do one of two things, either participate in one of two-day workshops about Students as Partners, and we encourage you, if you're a member of staff, to bring a student with you, or if you're a student, bring a member of staff with you. Alternatively, if you want to develop this strategically as an initiative in your institution, bring a team with you. 4 to 6 people, which at least 2 are students and 2 are staff, and we will spend the 4 days helping you work through that project with other teams. So the last 2 years we've had either 6 or 7 teams from about 10 different countries now come for that period. It's a very powerful way of developing an initiative so that you can go back to your institution and really apply it. So not changing, no? Stop running. Can you change the next slide for me? This one's not working for some reason. Let's do. So the idea is, as I said at the beginning, this is an aspiration. We're well along the road in some areas, particularly on the left-hand side of the diagram. We've hardly started in some of the areas, more so on the right-hand side of the diagram. So it's an aspiration for a journey that we ought to be taking in this area. Next slide, please. But the argument I've been trying to make today is that getting students to produce knowledge rather than just to consume knowledge is, for me, the best way to get that link between teaching and research. The challenge is to mainstream it. And part of the issue is what you'll count as research, which I deliberately use the word inquiry as well. If you broaden the definition, perhaps take one of the 4 scholarships involved, or some of the IMELT ideas here, which go beyond the normal just discovery research, then it is easier to do. Next slide, please. Quoting again Angela Brew, and she was talking specifically about undergraduate research in this quote, though I think it applies more broadly to the whole Students as Partners agenda. She has an aim to develop knowledge, inclusive, scholarly, knowledge-building communities. That, for me, is what higher education should be about. That's where the transformative bit is at. Many of you will buy into that agenda. It's why you've come to this conference. But it means power sharing. Many of our colleagues would find that challenging. Some of you may find that challenging. It needs courage to give up some control. So I think there's a need to do some more thinking outside the box and to be creative, but to recognize that not everybody says thinking outside the box is a good idea. Next slide, please. It's clicking now, is it? Right. Now, I said at the beginning, I Googled melt your mind. And one of the things I found there was fascinating. There's a pop song by a group called Mutoed Man entitled Melt Your Mind. So I thought very appropriately, and thinking of the dance we're going to have later on with the international one, to get you in the mood for that, I'm going to play the first minute of this. If you want to dance, welcome. Please join in. Listen to this. In case you couldn't follow the words, that's what they actually said there. The one bit I would disagree with is the last bit, don't let it melt your mind. I say, yes, do let it melt your mind. Perhaps this will be the song for the conference to follow on. So thank you all very much. I do need to end, though, on the dogs. And that's my daughter, Ruth, who last time I gave a presentation on Students as Partners, we co-presented in the Netherlands. Lovely to do it with my daughter. So thank you all very much.